We have opportunities for you. We also have had the great opportunity to take a date at the Boone County Fair. So this year, we are asking for volunteers, and let me tell you, we're going to need all hands on deck, because this is 6 days with 5 shifts, with a potential of 3 people in each shift. Anybody do the math on that? That means we've got 90 shifts that we could fill. This is for a church fundraiser, which means that we could potentially earn thousands of dollars by supporting our fair and our church. Please, please, please sign your name and encourage others to take the time. They are 3-hour shifts. If you have any problems with that, please talk to me and we'll see if we can cut a shift down or something so that we don't get anybody into an uncomfortable space. But there's lots of opportunities, whether you're a morning person or an evening person, there is a space for you. You are welcome to sign up with family and friends, but we want at least one person on every shift, preferably. So if you're able to spread it out, please do so. You are welcome to take multiple shifts, but to a limit. And I can't remember what that limit is, but I think it's around 20. You want to keep under 20 hours, if possible. So I will update on the shift limit, but you are welcome to sign up for multiple shifts. Gene?
What is our duties?
Your duties will deal with tickets. So there is usually a training that goes along with it. So we will, when you sign up, once we know when the trainings will be, we will let you know.
Okay, thank you.
So I'm going to start this.
I was just curious because my chorus is cooking breakfast.
Yes. Also, as I will not be very helpful in the garden this week, I am inviting you, if you are interested in helping in the garden or learning more about the garden, please check with me before Thursday, and I'll give you a little tour, and we'll talk about different things that can be done in the garden. We are preparing for a garden tour in 2 weeks, on Saturday in 2 weeks. They're going to be touring St. John's Community Garden as well as the other community gardens around our area, so like the health department, the library, and the Buchanan Street Gardens. So if you can't help out in the garden, I do encourage you to take the tours, because each garden is so different. They all have different programs, and they are a blessing to our communities. Are there any other special announcements?
Thank you. better.
No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here.
I invite you to wave and give blessing to those around you in this space as we thank God for each other and this time we have together. Let us join in that celebration as we sing together, God bless our native land.
Thank you.
Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. See what large letters I make when I am writing in my own hand. It is those who want to make a good showing in the flesh that they compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not be persecuted through the cross of Christ. Even the circumcised do not themselves obey the law, but they want you to be circumcised that you may boast about your flesh. May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision or uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything. As for those who will follow this rule, peace be upon them and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. The Lord bless the reading and hearing of this scripture and use it in the building of our faith. Amen. I'll give you a little hint. Paul's a little perturbed with this church. There's a lot of different things that are happening in the church, but what he's struggling with is always behavior. They're not caring for each other, they're not supporting one another, and while Paul seems to be double-tongued at times when he says that we are called to help each other with each other's burdens, but then we all must be accountable for our own load, he's talking about present and future. We are called by God and by our apostles to help each other, to help carry the yoke. When someone is in need, we help. We don't sit around and figure out what got them into that need in the first place, because that is the load they will carry the rest of their life. That is the load that God will talk to them about. But when God comes to talk to us, God will say, "And what did you do?" Paul is concerned about a community that is so taken over by their own loads that they don't realize that they have the ability to help each other through and make the loads less. It is common for writers in this time to use a scribe or someone else to write a letter, and we know that Paul did this quite often. But at the end, when it's time to sign up, he picks up the writing with his own hand and even makes fun of it, which is such a strange thing to read in the Bible, especially because we're all reading it from probably at times New Roman font. That doesn't change. And I wish that we had that original text, that original writing, where we could see the difference in Paul's handwriting, because we have all kinds of ideas as to why his handwriting is so atrocious. And it's not because he isn't well-read or not educated. We think it has more to do with some of his own ailments and his own struggles. He himself writes in this sign-off that the scars of Christ, the signs of Christ, are on his body, which refer to the kinds of abuse and trauma that his body had literally gone through by being a messenger of God. This man has been beaten, whipped, and stoned. He's been shipwrecked, and he survived. after all, is a Jew. He went around and preached mostly to the Jews. His disciples were primarily Jewish, and when they went to celebrate anything, it was a Jewish festival. So it makes sense. But when Paul comes into ministry, he comes in as a good Jew, but he comes in as a good Jew who has persecuted these Christ followers. And he realizes that the faith that he had held around all of the important laws and scriptures in Judaism didn't quite fill what Jesus was teaching. And Paul looks around and sees all of these great Gentiles who are hearing the story of Christ, and they're coming to faith in a whole new way. His ministry is surrounded by the idea that we will not put any stumbling block in front of a person. And I can only imagine what kind of stumbling block circumcision would be to an adult. But there are many who would tell the people in the church of Galatia
to a new listening. We are called to be Christians. And as I said, I would be happy to spend many hours telling people exactly how to live. I would love to interpret scripture and tell people what that scripture means. And all of that time, I also know that most of the time people will not hear me at all. Doesn't matter how many degrees I get, how well spoken I become, it doesn't matter, because we are led by our spirits and also emotions. And sometimes God calls all of us into humility. Paul sometimes has a double tongue because he recognizes his need for humility in his own zealousness. When he was still called Saul, he was indeed a zealot to the extent that he watched someone be stoned to death and he approved of the action, even held people's coats as they went and did the deed. And then he went and searched to do it more. He was not a person who could do anything by half measure. He put his whole self in. But throughout his ministry, and even in his own letters, you can see him calling himself to account. Recognizing in others when their call for community to be circumcised and follow the letter of the Jewish law without recognizing the spirit that is already there, he sees how problematic it is. And how ego had gotten in the way of these missionaries. And then in the midst of his condemning the missionaries, he recognizes he must too pull back. He must humble himself and he must pray that he never gets to be so big in the head. It is a hard struggle to be a leader like Paul, but also remember that humility. To go forth and show the strength of God, but also remember your own weaknesses. And I'll be honest, Paul doesn't always do it great. There's at least one time when he talks about, well, thank God I've never baptized any of you, except for, well, I mean, these people and these people. He talks about being human, having humility, and not needing that sign of God's covenant, but then at the end signs off, in a way, boasting about his own physical sign. He is a man who loves God with his whole heart. He carries the signs of Christ with him. And while he recognizes those signs as stigmatas on his hand, lash marks on his back, deformities from being stoned, we, as modern Christians, have never seen those marks, never touched his hand, never watched him walk. But the marks he leaves on our hearts are marks that we memorize in Sunday school and read when we need comfort. We read them in celebration of life's big milestones and in our greatest heartaches. These are the marks that Paul leaves, and he doesn't even know it. Let us be people of faith who find a way to leave a mark. And for every mark we think we've left, may God find all new ones so that God's glory is amplified and fulfilled. Amen. marks of our faith, we recognize one of the greatest symbols that Christ left for us. It is not the cross. It is not the power and glory of flame and fire like the Holy Spirit, but it is a simple meal. Today we celebrate this meal of communion to recognize that we are called. We are called to the table to celebrate our faith and remember Christ's gift to us. For on the night of betrayal and desertion, Jesus took the bread, broke it, saying, "This is my body which is broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup of the new covenant, poured it, saying, "This is my blood which is shed for you. Take and drink in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the wonders of our faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Let us celebrate our faith at this table. Gracious God, we thank you for inviting us to this table. May it increase our love for you and for each other, and renew us in faith so we might be invigorated to go forth and spread your good news to all who will hear it. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
As we gather for worship at St. John's, we recognize that there are many ways we are able to give our thanks to God. And we take time during our time of tithe and offering so that we can bring forth and dedicate gifts, whether it is a gift of time and talent that we plan to do throughout the week or month, or a time of treasure. We give thanks for all these good gifts. And each month we designate a little bit extra, and we go the second mile so that we might give beyond our walls. This month's second mile and mission offering goes to Carpenter's Place. Carpenter's Place is a transitional housing space for people who are trying to come out of a situation of homelessness. We put the second mile into our wooden plates, and we have the bronze plates to put in the general fund so that we might help continue the grander missions of St. John's throughout the year. Come, and let us give as generously as we are able. If you have nothing to physically put in the plate, we invite you to hold it and offer prayer. Offerings and your people to be